This book is intended as general information only and should not be used to diagnose or treat any health condition. In light of the complex, individual, and specific nature of health problems, this book is not intended to replace professional medical advice. The ideas, procedures, and suggestions in this book are intended to supplement, not replace, the advice of a trained medical professional. Consult your physician before adopting any of the suggestions in this book, as well as about any condition that may require diagnosis or medical attention. The author and publisher disclaim any liability arising directly or indirectly from the use of this book. Simon & Schuster Audio presents Gut Health Hacks, 200 Ways to Balance Your Gut Microbiome and Improve Your Health, by Lindsay Boyers, CHNC. Technical review by Murdoch Kalegi, MD. Read by Lessa Lamb. Introduction. It's time to harness the amazing power of your gut. The health of your gut is vital to proper digestion, but that's only the tip of the iceberg. Your gut health is also tied to your immune function, your mental health, and your overall state of health and well-being. If your gut is out of whack, it's impossible to live your best life. But with so much information out there, it can feel overwhelming to try to sort through it all. Enter Gut Health Hacks. In this book, you'll find 200 hacks that help streamline everything there is to know about improving your gut health. You'll learn how to test your current gut function, the best dietary and lifestyle changes you can make to support your gut, and how you can improve your gut health by prioritizing your mental health. The hacks in this book can not only lead to profound positive changes in your gut health, but they're also simple to incorporate. You can start by doing a handful of things at a time and working your way up to living a lifestyle that fully supports your gut health. Or you can dive right in and give your life a complete gut health overhaul. The choice is yours. Whether you're hearing about the importance of gut health for the first time, or you're looking for some actionable steps to build on what you know, this book is here to keep your gut in tip-top shape. Chapter 1. Do the right tests to assess your gut health. If you're listening to this book, there's a good chance you already suspect that you're dealing with some gut issues. You might have digestive symptoms like gas, bloating, diarrhea, and/or stomach pain, or some less obvious signs like fatigue, headaches, rashes, and joint pain. More than likely, you have a combination of both. But no matter what your personal gut concerns, the tests in this chapter will help you pinpoint what's going on and which factors are contributing to your issues. You'll learn how to analyze your poop. Don't worry, you don't have to touch it. Your skin, your digestive symptoms, and your body odor to uncover what's going on underneath the surface. You'll also learn how certain vitamins, minerals, and other nutritional compounds play a role in gut health, and how to see if your body is getting adequate amounts of each. Some tests you can easily do at home using common pantry ingredients like baking soda. Others require you to get your healthcare provider involved. You can start with one or do them all. The choice is yours. But once you uncover the things that may be contributing to your gut issues, you'll be ready to move on to the rest of the hacks in this book to restore your gut health. Number 1. Watch for signs. This may not be a true test, but taking note of your symptoms and identifying any patterns are vital parts of assessing your gut health. When you think of your gut, some symptoms point to a problem, like gas, bloating, constipation, diarrhea, stomach pain, heartburn, burping. But there are a lot of not-so-obvious signs, too. If your gut is out of whack, it can affect your whole body in a negative way, leading to systemic symptoms that you might not even connect to your gut unless you're really paying attention. Some of these symptoms include cravings, especially for sugar or processed carbohydrates, unexplained weight loss or weight gain, anxiety, low mood, insomnia, difficulty falling or staying asleep, skin rashes, acne, eczema, and/or psoriasis, poor concentration, chronic fatigue, any autoimmune disease. Keep in mind that these lists aren't all-inclusive. If you have any chronic, lingering symptoms that won't go away, keep track of them and see if you can find any correlations with your stress levels, diet, or overall lifestyle. If you can, fixing your gut may help solve, or at least improve, the problem. Number 2. Journal it. A helpful way to connect any symptoms with your diet is to keep a food journal. Food journals help you identify which types of foods might be causing any persistent symptoms. It's really simple. All you have to do is write down what you ate, when you ate, any symptoms that you noticed that day, what your mood is like, how much energy you have, how well or not well you slept. It is important to write down everything you eat, no matter how small or insignificant you think it is. If you're sensitive to gluten, even a bite or two can cause symptoms, so you want to make sure you're accurately keeping track. It's also important to write down every symptom or anything that feels off. You may not connect certain symptoms with your digestion, but they may be closely related. For example, joint pain, poor memory, and fatigue are all signs of poor gut health, but they're not as obvious as other signs, like bloating or diarrhea. Keep in mind that although many people have learned to live with nagging or uncomfortable symptoms, they're not normal. Even if you've been dealing with something for several years and you've learned to adapt, write it down. You may be able to connect it to something you're eating. Another thing to keep in mind is that symptoms don't always show up right away. You may react to something you've eaten 2 or 3 days later. So pay attention to those connections and patterns, too. Number 3. Eliminate some foods. An elimination diet isn't a scientific test, but it's one of the most effective ways to identify food sensitivities. To follow a basic elimination diet, avoid the most common food allergens and gut irritants for a set period of time, usually 30 days. These allergens include gluten, soy, dairy, eggs, sugar and all sweeteners, grains, including corn and oats, nightshade vegetables, white potatoes, eggplant, peppers, and tomatoes, alcohol, caffeine, does not include herbal teas. After the initial 30 days, which is called the removal period, move to the reintroduction phase. During this period, slowly bring the eliminated foods back into your diet, one at a time. For example, eat dairy for 2 to 3 days and then take note of any symptoms that return or flare up. If you don't experience any symptoms, you can generally assume that your gut is tolerating that specific food pretty well, and you can move on to reintroducing the next food. However, if you do experience symptoms, go back to your elimination diet for the next few days before reintroducing the next food. The goal with an elimination diet is to identify which foods are a trigger for you and then to remove them from your diet, at least temporarily. Number 4. Look before you flush. After you've gone number 2, you may just want to flush it and forget it, but looking at your poop can give you insights into the current state of your gut. An easy way to determine if your stool and gut is healthy is the Bristol stool chart. This chart breaks poop into 7 types. Type 1 looks like separate hard lumps or pebbles. This type of poop indicates low levels of good bacteria or constipation. Type 2 looks like hard pebbles connected together, resembling a lumpy sausage. This type of poop signals constipation or can be a sign of irritable bowel syndrome. Type 3 looks like one solid poop, but with cracks on the surface. This indicates that you may be dehydrated and constipation is likely, although it's still considered fairly normal. Type 4 looks like one smooth, continuous log. This is an ideal-looking poop. Type 5 looks like individual blobs, but there are still edges on each piece. This is the start of diarrhea and shows that you may not be digesting food properly, especially if undigested food particles are present. Type 6 looks mushy, with some lumps still present. This is a sign of increased transit time, the time it takes food to travel through the digestive tract, and can indicate a gut disorder. Type 7 is watery, with no solid pieces at all. This can come from gut infections, either chronic or short-term, like food poisoning, or eating something that doesn't agree with you. While certain poop characteristics are considered normal, everyone is unique. Looking at your poop can help you figure out what's normal.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.